Welcome to today's webinar. I was being given the opportunity to start this webinar. Richard Feynman, in his keynote talk at the first conference of physics and computation in 1981 at MIT, asked a fundamental question: can quantum physics be simulated by a classical computer? The answer is strictly no. Why? Because that is due to the limited capacity and limited storage of the classical computer. Then there comes the next question: can quantum physics be simulated on a quantum computer? The answer is still not known. And that question started the race for building quantum computers. They have organized this webinar today to give the students and the audience some glimpses of quantum information processing and quantum computation. But why should we learn it? Just think about some of the budget allocations of some of the countries around the world. The budget at US earmarked nearly $500,000 for quantum technology. And that includes building a quantum internet, including 17 national labs across US. And the European Commission is going to spend around 550 million euros for funding quantum research in Europe. And what about our country? In her budget speech, our finance minister this year had announced that India is going to spend around 8,000 crores of rupees over the next 5 years for developing quantum technologies. And to be speaking frankly, private players are not far behind. Every big private company like Google, IBM, and Microsoft all had jumped into this fray. So the speaker in her authority is an eminent person in this field with many publications in reputed journals. And she is going to give us an idea about what is going on around the world and what are the basics of this quantum information and technology. Without much delay, I would like to invite the speaker to deliver her talk. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Kaushikda. So today we are going to talk about quantum information and quantum computation. So, okay. So the title of the talk is Quantum Information and Computation, the Beginning of a New Era. So from the title, it is very clear that we are going to talk about something new thing which we didn't have before. So, this new thing comes from using quantum mechanics, which is called quantum supremacy. So in quantum domain, we have something which is not possible in classical domain. That is called quantum supremacy. So in quantum domain, we can achieve something more than classical computation. So that is quantum supremacy. So in this talk, we will see how quantum supremacy can be used in various fields. This quantum supremacy can be used in medicine, can be used in biology, can be used in machine learning, can be used in AI, artificial intelligence. But the huge impact of this quantum supremacy is in the field of cryptology. So today's talk, I am going to talk about how we use quantum supremacy in the field of cryptology. So what is cryptology? Cryptology is the science of hiding some information with the help of some hard problem, which are believed to be hard in classical computer, finding the solution of those problem takes a long time. So based on this idea, we now design some cryptographic protocol to give the security of the information. But in quantum domain, we will see that we need not require this hardness of the problem. We use some basic laws of physics, and using that, we can give the security of cryptologic primitives. So in this talk, we will discuss that. So the outline of the talk is as follows. First, we will discuss some introductory things, cryptologic aspects. Then we will discuss the basics of quantum computation and information, that is qubit entanglement and quantum gates. Then we will discuss quantum supremacy by some example, by CHHS game, teleportation, demo-state preparation, no cloning, indistinguishability of quantum states. Then we will discuss how we can use this quantum supremacy in quantum key distribution in Dois-Sos algorithm. And then we will very briefly discuss about Grover algorithm, Simon and Shor, and how those algorithms can be used in cryptography. We will just scan through that, those. Now, the basic model of classical computers, initially visualized by Alan Turing, von Neumann, and several other researchers during 1930s. But the model of that computers actually was based on classical physics. That is why this is called classical computers. After 52 years, in 1982, Richard Feynman, he proposed a seminal idea of universal quantum simulator, or more informally, a quantum computer. So what is quantum computer? Informally speaking, quantum computer is a system of more than one particles whose dimension can be explained by a Hilbert space whose dimension is exponentially large in the number of particles. What is that? Does that mean? That means that if the system consists of single particle, then the dimension of the system will be 2. If the system consists of 2 particles, then the dimension becomes 4. If the system consists of 3 particles, then the dimension became 8, and so on. That is why this line, the dimension is exponentially large in number of the particles. Thus, one naturally expects that a quantum system can efficiently solve a problem that may require exponential time on a classical computer. And this conjecture became proved true when, during 1980s, Dois-Josa in 1992 and Grover in 1996 came out with some quantum algorithms where they showed that the quantum algorithms are exponentially faster than their classical counterparts. So we will discuss those algorithms briefly. Most importantly, in 1994, Peter Shor, he discovered that in quantum paradigm, factorization and Riskit-Lock problem, these two problems, factorization and Riskit-Lock problem, these two problems are believed to be hard in classical domain. That means finding the solution of these two problems requires exponential, a long, long time. But these two problems can be efficiently solved if we have a quantum computer and we use Shor's algorithm. This has a huge implication in classical public key cryptography, PKC. So P for public, K for key, and C for cryptography. In public key cryptography, this Shor algorithm has a huge impact. Large-scale fault-tolerant commercial quantum computers are still elusive. However, as Kaushik already mentioned, that the companies like IBM, Microsoft, Google, Rigetti, D-Wave, they are providing some quantum facility, a quantum computer facility. Installing some toolkit, we can write programs, we can run those programs, and can view the result which comes from the actual quantum computers. For IBM, the toolkit is Quantum Information Toolkit, QISKit. For Microsoft, this is Quantum Development Key, KIT, QDK for Google. This is CIRQ for Rigetti, Forest Quantum Computing Software for DOF. This is Ocean Tools Suites. So we have to install this software in our laptop or PC. Then we can run, we can write the programs and run our program. In August 2015, the US National Security Agency, NSA, released a major public policy statement on the need for post-quantum cryptography, PQC. What was that statement? The statement was as follows. For those partners and vendors that have not yet made the transition to SUTB algorithms, which is called elliptic curve cryptography, for the time being, just remember this name, elliptic curve cryptography. We recommend not making a significant expenditure to do so at this point, but instead to prepare for the upcoming quantum resistance algorithm transition. This announcement clearly states two things. One, people who had not yet upgraded from RSA to ECC. RSA means Rivest Shamir Adelman Public Key Crypto System to ECC should not do so, and people should be ready for the future upgrades to post-quantum protocols. These are the signals that practical quantum computers might not be a distant dream. Many commercial quantum devices are already available in market. For example, QKD, quantum key distribution devices, QTRNG, quantum true random number generator. Those devices are already available in international market. And we already mentioned that some quantum computers are publicly available. 14 qubit quantum computers, we can, IBM actually providing this facility, and we can use these 14 qubit quantum computers without free of cost. So that signals that we are approaching towards a quantum era. The pioneering developments in the domain of classical cryptography during 1970s are Diffie-Hellman key exchange protocol, RSA Rivest Shamir Adelman public crypto system, elliptic curve crypto system, and nowadays the crypto system we are using actually based on these three primitives, Diffie-Hellman, RSA, and ECC, elliptic curve crypto systems. Diffie-Hellman crypto systems, Diffie-Hellman key exchange protocol actually based on Brisket law problem. RSA based on factorization of a large number. Those are believed to be hard in use in classical domain. Using classical computer, we cannot find the solution of discrete log problem or factorization of a large number in a very short time. We require long time to find the solution of these two problems. That is why this is a hard problem. These problems are called hard problem. But Peter Shor, I already mentioned that in 1994, Peter Shor showed that there exists a quantum algorithm. Using that, we can solve this discrete log and factorization in a polynomial time, in a very short time. So security will be compromised in post-quantum era. So we require some solution. When quantum computers comes, then we require some alternative solution. In classical domain, there are some post-quantum crypto system, that is Lattice, for example, Lattice-based and code-based crypto systems. Those are classical crypto system. Considerable research is going on these crypto systems, but those are not as efficient as RSA or ECC. Those may be used shortly in commercial domain in case quantum computer arrives. Alternative solution is quantum cryptography. What is quantum cryptography? Quantum cryptography provides security against quantum adversary. What is quantum adversary? We assume that quantum adversary has unbounded power of computation. Now, by post-quantum cryptography, we commonly imply classical cryptographic public key algorithms which are resistant against quantum attacks, such as lattice-based and code-based cryptography. But in broader perspective, post-quantum cryptography means we have to understand the post-quantum scenario. And what is that? Why this post-quantum scenario comes? This post-quantum scenario comes for quantum supremacy. In quantum domain, we can achieve this quantum supremacy in three forms. One is processor or circuit. Using some quantum processor and circuit, we can achieve the supremacy. That is called quantum parallelism. We will discuss that. Then in terms of secrecy, we can achieve quantum supremacy. That comes from no cloning theorem. In terms of communication, we can see quantum supremacy, and for that we require entanglement. We will discuss that, what is entanglement. So we need to exploit quantum supremacy as a whole, not in parts, in post-quantum era. So these are the introduction. Now preliminaries, the basic building blocks of quantum information and quantum computation. We are familiar with the bits 0 and 1. The classical quantum counterpart of this classical bit is quantum bit 0, that is the kth 0. This symbol, BSc students and surely MSc students, they are familiar with this the symbol, kth symbol. So this classical bit 0 can be represented, can be replaced by quantum bit kth 0, and this classical bit 1 can be replaced in quantum domain by quantum bit or qubit kth 1. So this is kth 0 and this is kth 1. The physical representation, physically we can visualize these 0 and 1 by photon or electron. If we choose the degree of polarization, degree of freedom of a photon, then horizontally polarized light can be viewed as kth 0 and vertically polarized light can be viewed as kth 1. Similarly, if we consider electrons and electronic spin, then up spin can be viewed as kth 0 and down spin can be viewed as kth 1. Now, the qubit has a unique property which we can't see in bit. A qubit can be lie in the superposition of these kth 0 and 1. So a qubit can be written as alpha 0 plus beta 1. This is the general form of a qubit, where alpha beta are complex number and mod alpha square plus mod beta square equal to 1. So put alpha equal to 1 and beta equal to 0, you will get 0, kth 0. And put beta equal to 1, alpha equal to 0, you will get kth 1. So this is the general form of a qubit, alpha 0 plus beta 1. When we measure this qubit, in 0, 1 basis, this is 1 basis, then we will get either 0 or 1. We will get 0 with probability mod alpha square, and we will get 1 with probability mod beta square. And after the measurement, the original states alpha 0 plus beta 1 gets destroyed and we will get either 0 or 1. For example, suppose 1 plus I by 2 0 plus 1 by root 2 1, this is a qubit. Why? This is a, here alpha is 1 plus I by 2, so mod alpha square equal to half. And here beta is 1 by root 2, so mod beta square equal to half. So half plus half equal to 0. So this condition is satisfied. And so this is a valid qubit. When we measure this qubit, we will get 0 with probability mod alpha square. That is 1 plus I by 2 mod square, which is equal to half. And we will get 1 with probability 1 by root 2 mod square, which is equal to half. And the original qubit, 1 plus I by 2 0 plus 1 by root 2 1, that qubit gets destroyed. One may theoretically pack infinite amount of information in a single qubit. How? We can represent alpha or beta with infinite number of bits. And in that way, we can actually pack infinite amount of information in alpha and beta. So in a single qubit may contain huge information compared to a bit. A bit is a single bit, 0 or 1, but here we can pack infinite amount of information inside alpha and beta. But it is not very clear how we can extract such information. To extract such information correctly, we require infinite asymptotically large number of same qubits. So we require that alpha 0 plus beta 1 very large quantity. So and that is actually in practice, this is not possible. So it is not very clear how we can extract that information which is hidden in alpha and beta in exact manner. Technology is still at early stage. Lot of problems in computation, storage, and communications are there. Now, basic algebra. Think about 2-qubit system. So 1 qubit is alpha 1 0 plus beta 1 1, and another qubit is alpha 2 0 plus beta 2 1. So this is a 2-qubit system, but these 2 qubits are independent to each other. So they are not dependent on each other. This system can be written as tensor product of 2 different qubits. So the resultant tensor product will be this: alpha 1 alpha 2 0 0, alpha 1 beta 2 0 1, beta 1 alpha 2 1 0 plus beta 1 beta 2 1 1. But any 2-qubit system cannot be written in the tensor product of 2 independent qubits. Suppose this system, gamma 1 0 0 plus gamma 2 1 1, where gamma 1 gamma 2 not equal to 0. This system cannot be decomposed as the tensor product of 2 individual qubits. These type of systems are called entangled systems. One example, 0 0 plus 1 1 by root 2, here gamma 1 equal to gamma 2 equal to 1 by root 2. So these are called maximally entangled states. There are another 3 maximally entangled states: 0 0 minus 1 1 by root 2, 0 1 plus 1 0 by root 2, 0 1 minus 1 0 by root 2. Now this is the tensor product. You can just look at this. Now quantum gates. We are familiar with classical gates. So n input or n outputs or n inputs, single output. So classical gates are not reversible. Think about XOR gate. So what is XOR gate? It can take 2 inputs and gives single output. So this is not reversible gate. For reversibility, we need n number of inputs and n number of outputs. Quantum gate must be reversible. So there should be n number of inputs and n number of outputs. And these quantum gates can be represented by 2 to the power n plus 2 to the power n unitary matrices. Some example, single input, single output quantum gates, X gate. What is X gate? It is exactly the this X gate behaves exactly like our classical NOT gate. So what it does, it converts 0 to 1 and 1 to 0. So if we apply X gate on a qubit alpha 0 plus beta 1, we will get beta 0. So this one becomes 0 and alpha 1. So this 0 becomes 1. Now Z gate, you can't find any analog, any similar gates in classical domain. This is called phase gate. What this gate does, it flips the phase of what? So when we apply Z gate on 0, 0 remains 0, but when we apply Z gate on 1, it becomes minus 1. So when we apply Z gate on alpha 0 plus beta 1, it becomes alpha 0 minus beta 1. Another unique gate is H gate. You can't find any similar gate of H in classical domain. This is called superposition. It creates superposition. When we apply this H gate on 0, it gives us 0 plus 1 by root 2 equals superposition of 0 and 1. And when we apply this H gate on 1, again this gives the equal superposition of 0 and 1, but with minus sign here. So when we apply this H gate on alpha 0 plus beta 1, we will get alpha 0 plus 1 by root 2 and beta 0 minus 1 by root 2. The matrix representation of X gate is this: 0 1 1 0, Z gate is 1 0 0 minus 1, and H gate is this: 1 by root 2 1 by root 2 1 by root 2 minus 1 by root 2. Now I will show you how using this single qubit gate, we can generate a deterministic. So any algorithm which gives us random stream that is not actually truly random. This is called pseudo-random stream. But in quantum domain, using these single qubit gates, we can generate true random bit stream. So how we can generate that? This is a simple circuit. We start with qubit 0. Then we apply Hadamard gate on qubit 0. This will give us 0 plus 1 by root 2. Now we will measure this 0 plus 1 by root 2 in 0 1 basis. So what we will get after measurement? We will get either 0 or 1 with probability half, because here alpha is 1 by root 2, beta is 1 by root 2. First, so we will get 0 with probability half, we will get 1 with probability half. So with probability half, we will get 0 or we will get 1. Now again we start with 0 qubit, again we will apply Hadamard gate. Again, we will get 0 plus 1 by root 2. Then again, we will measure and we will get either 0 or 1. In this way, repeating this circuit again and again, we can generate true random bit stream, which is not possible in quantum domain, in classical domain, using our deterministic classical computer. This is the circuit. In IBM Q, this is the example of IBM Q implementation. So if you go in IBM Q circuit composer, you can see this and you can drag this. This is the gates and this is the measurement operation. So you can drag these gates here. This is the qubits, input qubits. So you can drag these gates here. And you can generate your own circuit. So here we draw our own circuit. This circuit, actually this circuit. So we apply Hadamard gate. We start with 0. We apply Hadamard gate and then measure. And we repeat this circuit several times. And we get this result. So before that, I like to mention that this is the Qiskit program for this circuit. This is the Qiskit program. So here, when you try to write Qiskit program, something you have to remember. One is token. So this is your actually API token, where you have to installing Qiskit, you have to open an account. And when you open your account, you will get this API token. So this is your token. This is your identity. Then this is the URL. And then you have to define some quantum register. Here I define two. I am dealing with two quantum registers. And you have to define some classical register. Here I am dealing with two classical registers. So why quantum register and classical register? We have to measure the quantum registers. And the measurement result is stored in classical registers. Now this is my circuit. This is my program. Now here we have to mention the backend. So which they are in IBM Q platform, there are many processors. One is simulator and other three, four are actual quantum processors. So you have to mention in which processor you want to run your program. Here I am writing IBM Q16 Melbourne. This is a actual quantum processor. So you have to mention that. Then comes number of shots. What is number of shots? Number of shots means how many times you want to repeat your algorithm. You want to run your algorithms. So this is the number of shots. I repeat my circuits 18192 times. Okay, so this is the Qiskit program. Now this is the result. First, I run my program in quantum simulator. I am dealing with two qubits and I actually use the single, the last qubit, this qubit. So my circuit, what my circuit gives? My circuit gives either 0 or 1, and 0 we will get with probability half and 1 we will get with probability half. Here also, you can see that last bit, 0, I am getting this 0. Last bit is that actual bit. I am dealing with this last bit. Though I am considering two qubits, but I am working on the last qubit. So I am getting 0 with probability some 47% and 1 with probability some 52%. So So this is the simulation and this is the actual processor. I am choosing, I told you that I am choosing IBM Q16 Melbourne, and in 16 Melbourne there are 14 qubits. That is why this 14 qubits comes. But I am using actually the last qubit. So here also 0 comes with some 51% probability and 1 comes with some 48% probability. So this is the result of the circuit. This is the physical device of quantum 2 random number generator. It comes in a USB port form. So this is, I am skipping this slide. This is the installation procedure. So this is the physical device. ID Quantiq, they are selling this device. This device is called Quantis. It generates quantum 2 random number generator. And inside the device, the simple circuit, they use the simple circuit. Now, two input, two output quantum gates. So that also can be seen as 2 to the power 2 plus 2 to the power 2 unitary matrices. So one very famous gate is CNOT gate. What is CNOT gate? There are two inputs. First input is called control and the second input is called target. When that control is 0, then target remains as it is. When the control will be 1, then target flips. So when we input 0, 0, we will get 0, 0. When we input 0, 1, we will get 0, 1. But when we input 1, 0, it becomes 1, 1. And when we input 1, 1, we will get 1, 0. This is the matrix representation of the CNOT gate. This is the IBM Q gate set. So I is identity, X I already told you, Z, Y is another gate. I am giving the matrix representation later. This is H, this is T gate, another gate, T dagger. This is the complex conjugate of this T gate, S dagger. U1, this is again single Q, single input, single output qubit, U2, U3. So these are the single input, single output qubit gate available in IBM Q interface. Two qubits gate set, these are in IBM Q interface is this CNOT, CZ. CNOT is also called CX, CZ, CY, CH, CU1, CU3, CRZ, and swap gate. And there is only three input, three output gate available in IBM Q, and that is Toffoli gate or CC.gate gate. So these are the matrix representation of T, A, CU1, U2. These are the single qubit, single input, single output gate. That is why the dimension of the matrix is 2 plus 2 to the power 1 plus 2 to the power 1. Single input, single output. This is the matrix representation of this is the matrix representation of two input, two output gates. So this is the CZ gate, CUI gate. These are called control gate. So here, one interesting thing you should note that all the control gates starts with, so we can divide the matrix in block diagonal form, in block matrix form. So 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, -1. And note that the first block diagonal matrix is identity matrix. And the last block diagonal matrix is the Z matrix for control Z. Here also, the first block diagonal matrix is the identity matrix. And the last block diagonal matrix is Y matrix. For you also, so any control, if you want to construct the matrix of any control gate, first you have to divide the matrix in some block matrices, and the first block diagonal matrix will be the identity and the last one will be the gate for which you want to construct the control gate. So for U1, this will be U11, U12, U21, and U22. For U3, U2, this will be the matrix element of U2 gate. For U3, this will be the matrix element of U3 gate. similarly for control R. So these are the identity and these are the R gate. This is control H gate. So this is the Hadamard matrix. Last block diagonal and first block diagonal is the identity matrix. So the swap gate, this is not the control gate. So the matrix representation is different. This is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. Now, three input, three output quantum gate, which is available in IBM Q interface, that is CC0 or Toffoli gate. This is the matrix representation of CC0 gate. Note that this is 8x8 matrix. Why 8x8? This is 2 to the power 3. So, three inputs, so 2 to the power 3 plus 2 to the power 3 matrix. Okay, now quantum entanglement. Quantum entanglement is a physical resource. The resource, this is also not available in classical domain. You can't find any similar kind of thing in classical domain. So quantum entanglement is physical resource like energy associated with the peculiar non-classical correlation that are possible between separated quantum systems. Entanglement can be measured, transformed, and purified. A pair of quantum systems in an entangled state can be used as a quantum information channel to perform computational and cryptographic tasks that are impossible for a classical system. We will show that how we can use quantum entanglement. So what is quantum entanglement? We discussed earlier. So quantum entanglement is a system which cannot be decomposed in the tensor product of individual qubits. So using this quantum entanglement, we will now see how we can do computational and cryptographic tasks between two distant parties. Now this is a one circuit to create quantum entanglement. So we start with two qubits, X and Y. We will apply Hadamard gate on X and we will apply C0 gate on X and Y. And ultimately we will get some quantum entangled states. So how we will do that? Starts with 0, 0. So X equal to 0, Y equal to 0. So when we apply Hadamard gate on 0, what we will get? We will get 0 plus 1 by root 2. And this Y will be 0 here. So here, before C0 gate, the entire system will be 0 plus 1 by root 2 tensor 0. That we can write at, as 1 by root 2 0, 0 plus 1, 0. Now we will apply C0 gate. So for first part, 0, 0 becomes 0, 0. And for second part, 1, 0, the control is 1. So 1, 0 becomes 1, 1. So as a result, we will get 1 by root 2, 0, 0 plus 1, 1 by root 2. Similarly, if we start with X equal to 0 and Y equal to 1, we will get, you can check that we will get 0, 1, plus 1, 0 by root 2. If we start with X equal to 1 and Y equal to 0, then we will end up with 0, 0, minus 1, 1 by root 2. And if we start with X equal to 1, Y equal to 1, we will get 0, 1, minus 1, 0 by root 2. So this is the circuit using what we can construct maximally entangled states, varying the value of X and Y. This is the IBM Q implementation of this circuit. So we start with here X equal to 0, Y equal to 0. First we apply Hadamard gate on X and then C0 gate on X and Y. And what we will get? We will get 1 by root 2, 0, 0 plus 1, 1. So when we will measure this 1 by root 2, 0, 0 plus 1, 1 in 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1 basis, then we will get 0, 0, either 0, 0 with probability half and or 1, 1 with probability half. So this we will expect that after measurement, we will get either 0, 0 with probability half or 1, 1 with probability half. Now we will see what we will get in IBM Q. So we run our circuit in two processors. One is simulator, another is actual quantum processor. So in case of simulator, we start with 4 qubits. So that is why 4 qubits are coming, but we actually using the last 2 qubits. So here we are getting 0, 0 with probability 48% and 1, 1 with probability 51%. So this is the simulation result. And but when we run our program in actual processor, that is IBM QX2, another actual processor, then you can see that with 0, 0 and 1, 1, we are getting 0, 1 and 1, 0, which shouldn't come in this circuit. This circuit provides us only, we start with 0 and 0, so we must get 0, 0 plus 1, 1 by root 2. So there is no place of 0, 1 and 1, 0, but here this 0, 1 and 1, 0 come. So this is the error actually. So actual why I am saying this, because I like to mention that the actual processors are not error free. So error appears in actual processor, whereas in case of simulation there is no error, but in case of actual processors error appears. Now we will see some example of quantum supremacy. So how using this entanglement and some quantum phenomena we can overperform over classical domain. So one game is CHHS game. So in CHHS game, what is that game? In CHHS game, Alice and Bob are two distant party. So there are two players, Alice and Bob. They are sitting far apart from each other. Alice is given an input X and Bob is given an input Y. The rule of the game is that after receiving the input, they cannot communicate between themselves. After getting the input, Alice will output a bit A and Bob will output a bit B. They will win when A or B will equal to X and Y. The best classical strategy, it can be shown that the best classical strategy is irrespective of the input, Alice will output 0 and Bob will output 0. Or irrespective of the inputs, Alice will output 1, Bob will output 1. In that case, this is the best classical strategy, and in that case, it can be shown that Alice and Bob will win the game with probability 0.75. Whereas, if they share the prior entanglement among themselves, then this probability will be increased and that probability will be 0.853. So, using the quantum entanglement, quantum strategy clearly outperforms classical strategy, and that comes from quantum entanglement. So this is one example of quantum supremacy. Now this is the IBM key implementation of the game. Here note that some conditional gate is used. So ID is a conditional gate. When the classical value of some variable will be 0, then we have to use ID. ID means identity gate. When the classical value of some classical registers will be 0, then we have to use UT grade. When it will be 1, then we have to use UT grade with some other parameters. So here we use some conditional gates. So for the time being, we are just skipping these things. Now quantum teleportation. Here also we will see that using the entanglement, how we can transmit some information from Alice's part to Bob's part. So Alice and Bob are far apart from each other, but using entanglement, we can just send some information from Alice's part to Bob's part. How we can do that? Quantum teleportation is a process in which quantum information can be transmitted from one location to another with the help of classical communication and previously shared quantum entanglement between the sending and receiving location. We can do that because it depends on classical communication, which can proceed no faster than the speed of light. So quantum teleportation cannot be used for faster than light transport or communication of classical bits. So this is a very important point. So quantum teleportation is not faster break the law of so quantum teleportation cannot be faster than the speed of light. Quantum teleportation is limited to the transfer of information rather than matter itself. It provides a way of transporting a qubit from one location to another without having to move a physical particle along with it. So in quantum teleportation, no physical particle is transmitted from one location to another location. Only information is transmitted from one location to another location with the help of entanglement. So we have to note that thing. So in quantum teleportation, no physical particle is transmitted from one part to another part. Only the information is transmitted from one portion to another portion. This is the circuit for quantum entanglement. Alice and Bob, they are sitting far apart from each other, but they are sharing some entangled states among themselves. Prior to quantum teleportation, Alice and Bob share maximally entangled states. Here, beta 0,0 means 0,0 plus 1,1 by root 2. They are sharing this entanglement among themselves. So Alice have the first part of the entangled states, and Bob have the rest of the parts of entangled states with him. Now Alice wants to send Shamshai. This is a qubit. So Alice wants to send this Shai from her part to Bob's part. So Bob sent. So from her location to Bob's location, Alice wants to send this Shai. How can she do that? Now what? So Alice has Shai and Alice has the first part of the entangled state. So Alice has actually two particles. One is Shai, another is the first part of the entangled state beta 0,0. Alice first applies C0 gate on her two particles, on Shai and the first half of beta 0,0. Then she applies Hadamard gate on Shai, and after that she measures both of her particles. If she gets 0,0, so she measures these two particles in 0,0, 0,1, 1,0, 1,1 basis. If she gets 0,0, she conveys that 0,0 to Bob. If she gets 0,1, she conveys 0,1 to Bob, classical bit 0,1 to Bob. If she gets qubit 1,0, she conveys classical bit 1,0 to Bob. If she gets 1,1, she converts. So after measurement, Alice will get qubit, and the qubit she gets, she conveys the classical version of bits to Bob. So if she gets qubit 1,1, she will convey 1,1, classical bit 1,1 to Bob. And what Bob will do after getting 0,0, if Alice observes qubit 0,0, she will convey 0,0 to Bob. And after getting this 0,0, Bob immediately understands that he has nothing to do. The quantum state Shai already appears at her at his end. If Alice observes, if Alice measures qubit 0 and 1, she conveys this 0,1 to Bob, and immediately Bob comes to know that he has to apply X gate to get back this Shai. If Alice measures qubit 1 and 0, she conveys classical bit 1,0 to Bob, and Bob immediately understands that he has to apply Z gate on his particle, and after applying Z gate, he will get back this Shai. And if Alice observes qubit 1,1, she conveys classical bit 1,1 to Bob, and Bob immediately understands that he has to apply Z followed by X gate to get back this Shai. So in that way, the particle Shai destroyed at Alice's end and reappears at Bob's end. So this is the quantum teleportation. Note that no physical particle is transmitted through this channel. Only the information is transmitted through this channel with the help of classical communication and local, some local measurements. So this is the IBM key implementation of teleportation. Here also we are using some conditional gates. So when Alice observed 00, that means 0, Bob has to apply ID, the identity gate. That means nothing to do. When Alice observes 1, that means 01, 1 in bit form 01. So Bob has to apply X gate. When Alice observes 2, that means 10, Bob has to apply Z gate. When Alice observes 3, that means 11, Bob has to apply Z followed by X gate to get back the quantum state psi. So this is the IBM key implementation of teleportation. Now another thing is remote state preparation. Remote state preparation is very similar to quantum teleportation. Here also Alice and Bob shared some entangled states of the form 01 minus 10 by root 2. Here the and also here also Alice wants to send the qubit psi to Bob's end. But the difference between remote state preparation and teleportation is that in case of teleportation, so any psi can be written in this form. So cos theta by 2 0 plus sin theta by t to the power I phi 1. So this is alpha, cos theta by 2, this is alpha, and sin theta by t to the power I phi, this is beta. So in teleportation, Alice need not to know the value of theta or phi. But here, in case of remote state preparation, Alice has to know the value of theta. So this is the basic difference of remote state preparation and teleportation. In teleportation, psi will be completely unknown to Alice. But in case of remote state preparation, psi will be known to Alice but unknown to Bob. So how they will do that? They are sharing these entangled states. These entangled states can be written in these terms. Psi, psi perpendicular minus psi perpendicular psi by root 2. So what is psi perpendicular? This is the orthogonal states of this psi. So what will be the orthogonal state of this psi? Orthogonal states means if you are given two qubits, psi and phi, and if you calculate the dot product of psi and phi and you will get 0, then we will say that this psi and phi are orthogonal to each other. And if you will get some value other than 0, then we will say that psi and phi are non-orthogonal to each other. So the orthogonal state of psi will be sin theta by 2, 1, 0 minus cos theta by 2 e to the power I phi 1. So if we are taking phi perpendicular in that way, you can check that we will get the dot product of phi psi and psi perpendicular equal to 0. So psi perpendicular will be sin theta by 2 0 minus cos theta by 2 e to the power I phi 1. So these entangled states can be written in this form. Now what Alice will do? So first part is with Alice and the second part is with Bob. So Alice will measure her particle in psi perpendicular basis. When she gets psi, she conveys 0, classical bit 0, to Bob. When Bob gets 0, Bob immediately comes to know that at her end psi perpendicular is generated. So he has to apply some unitary operator which converts psi perpendicular to psi. And when Alice measures psi perpendicular, Alice conveys 1 to Bob. And when Bob gets 1, Bob immediately comes to know that psi is generated at his end. So he has nothing to do. So in that way, Alice can send psi from her location to Bob's location just by communicating a single bit. So in teleportation, Alice was communicating two classical bits. But in case of remote state preparation, here Alice is communicating only a single bit. So this is another difference between remote state preparation and teleportation. But that advantage comes in terms of, here Alice has to know the value of theta. If Alice do not know the value of theta, she cannot just by communicating a single bit, she cannot transfer this psi to Bob. So this is another thing. So using this kind of entanglement, Alice can send one qubit, a quantum state, from her location to Bob's location. Now, no cloning theorem. In classical domain, cloning is possible. So we can copy and paste, but in quantum domain, this is forbidden. This is first stated by Uters, Jurex, and Deeks in 1982. This has huge implication in quantum computing, quantum information, quantum cryptography, and related fields. So this is the proof. I am just skipping this. So this is one circuit by which, this is one example of example of a circuit by which we can prove that universal quantum cloning machine cannot be achievable. So this is the symbol of C0, you know. So using C0, you may notice that when we input 0, 0, this C0 outputs 0, 0, and when we inputs 1, 1, this 1, 0, the C0's outputs 1, 1. So we can actually, this is the control bit. So in target, we actually gets the copy of control bit. So C0 can be viewed as a cloning machine. So we can clone the control bit in target bit. So starts with 0, 0, you will get 0, 0, starts with 1, 0, you will get 1, 1. So control bit is copied in target bit. So C0 can be viewed as a cloning machine. But now we starts with an arbitrary qubit. Suppose 0 plus 1 by root 2. So what is our motivation? Our motivation is to see whether C0 gives us 1 by root 2 0 plus 1 into 1 by root 2 0 plus 1. So clone of 0 plus 1 by root 2, this is the control bit. So we want to get back this 0 plus 1 by root 2 in target bit. So what will happen in this case, we will see that. So we start with, so mu is 0 plus 1 by root 2 and target is 0. So before C0, it will be 1 by root 2 0 plus 1 by root 2 into 0. We can write it as 0, 0. Plus 1, 0 by root 2. Now we apply C0 gate. So 0, 0 will be 0, 0, but 1, 0 becomes 1, 1. So what we will get? We will get 0, 0 plus 1, 1 by root 2, which is an entangled state, and not, this cannot be decomposed as the tensor product of 0 plus 1 by root 2, tensor 0 plus 1 by root 2. So here this gate, this C0 gate, cannot clone the control bit in target bit. So C0 cannot be viewed as the universal cloning machine. So this is one example that universal cloning machine is not possible. Now, indistinguishability of non-orthogonal states. So what I told you, what is orthogonal states and non-orthogonal states? So 0 and 1 are orthogonal states. If you calculate the dot product of 0 and 1, you will get 0. If we calculate 1 by root 2 0 plus 1, 1 by root 2 0 minus 1, so these are two orthogonal states. If you calculate the dot product of these two, you will get 0. If we calculate the dot product of 1 by root 2 0 plus i1, 1 by root 2 0 minus i1, you will get 0. So this 0, 1, or 1 by root 2 0 plus 1, 1 by root 2 0 minus 1, or 1 by root 2 0 plus i1, 1 by root 2 0 minus i1, these pairs are orthogonal to each other. However, if you take 0 and 1 by root 2 0 plus 1, the dot product won't give you 0. So 0 and 1 by root 2 0 plus 1 are not orthogonal states. Those are non-orthogonal states. Similarly, 1 and 1 by root 2 0 plus 1, 1 and 1 by root 2 0 minus 1, 1 and 1 by root 2 0 plus i1, 0 and 1 by root 2 0 minus i1, and so on. So those are non-orthogonal states. So if you are given two states, suppose psi and phi, And if those are non-orthogonal, so you can't distinguish them with probability 1. If those are distinguished, if those are orthogonal, then you can distinguish them with probability 1. So you can, with probability 1, you can distinguish 0 and 1. Or with probability 1, you can distinguish 1 by root 2 0 plus 1, 1 by root 2 0 minus 1. However, if you are given 0 and 1 by root 2 0 plus 1, you can't do that. You can't distinguish what is 0 and what is 1 by root 2 0 plus 1 with probability 1. So this is the indistinguishability of non-orthogonal states. And using these two, no cloning theorem and indistinguishability of non-orthogonal states, we are designing the cryptographic primitives. In classical domain, to design cryptographic primitives, we have to based on some hard problems. For example, Diskitla problem or factorization. But here we designed cryptographic primitive based on no cloning and indistinguishability of two non-orthogonal states. One example is BB84. It is first initiated by Charles Bennett and Gil Bartrath in 1979. The paper was not getting accepted initially. Finally, in 1984, it was accepted in a conference held in Bangalore. It is a very important paper, and it is evident from its citation. This is the scheme for quantum predistribution, the first protocol in the area of quantum cryptography. The basics of this protocol comes from the seminal concept by Weissner. So the basic idea of this BB84, this is the first cryptographic protocol in quantum cryptography domain. So what is the basic idea? The basic idea is to transmit 0 and 1, classical bit 0 and 1 securely. So there are two parties, Alice and Bob. They are far apart from each other. So Alice wants to send a sequence of 0 and 1 to Bob. And another important thing is this series of 0 and 1 should be sent to Bob securely. So no one can get the value which string is going through the channel. No one choose two non-orthogonal bases. So Alice will choose 0, 1 and 1 by root 2, 0 plus 1, 1 by root 2, 0, 1, 0 minus 1 bases. These are two non-orthogonal bases. And Alice encodes these 0, classical bits 0, by quantum bit 0 and or 1 by root 2, 0 plus 1 randomly. So sometimes she will encode this 0 by quantum bit 0, or and sometimes she will encode this classical bit 0 by quantum bits 1 by root 2, 0 plus 1. Similarly, sometimes Alice will encode this 1, classical bit 1, by quantum bit 1, and sometimes she will encode this classical bits 1 by quantum bits 1 by root 2, 0 minus 1. Why she does that? She can encode 0 by quantum bit 0 and 1 by quantum bit 1. If she did that, then what will happen? These 0 and 1 are orthogonal to each other. And when these qubits are sent through the public channel, where if the adversary has access, she can easily distinguish when 0 is going or when 1 is going, because that an orthogonal states are distinguishable. But as Alice encodes this classical bit 0 by two non-orthogonal states, so getting these qubits, Alice cannot distinguish when 0 is going or when 1 is going, and in that way we can secure the communication. Now, in that way, after this encoding, Alice sends that qubit through a public channel, through a public quantum channel where Eve has access. And when Bob gets all the qubits, she declares that I received all the qubits. Then Alice publicly announces the basis. So when she encodes this 0 by the basic, no basis, no, not she, Alice never says that in this instance I encode this 0 by 0. She only says that in this instance I choose for encode for I choose this 0 1 basis. or in this n course instance I choose this 1 by root 2 0 plus 1 0 1 by root 2 0 minus 1 basis. So Alice publicly announces the basis for the instances, and what Bob will do after getting the qubits, Bob will measures the qubit in these two bases randomly. So with a very high probability, Bob, half of the cases Bob basis of measurement match with the Alice basis of encoding. So encoding basis and measurement basis with a very high probability matches in half of the cases. So they will keep those cases and through all other cases where the encoding basis didn't match with the measurement basis, and from the instances where the Alice's basis match with Bob's basis, the raw key will be generated. And after that, they will apply ECC error correcting code and privacy amplification. For the time being, I am skipping those. So this is the basic idea of BB84 quantum key distribution protocol. And here we only use indistinguishability of non-orthogonal states. No hard mathematical problem is used here. So this is another quantum example of quantum supremacy. This is the detailed algorithm of quantum key distribution. So I like to mention that there are commercial products, QKD commercial products are available in international market. ID QuantiQ, this company, they are selling these quantum QKD commercial products. Another company, MagicQ, they are also selling QKD commercial products, quantum QBox. So these are the companies. Now, what is the present trends in this domain, quantum key distribution domain? What is the present trend? Actually, the security of BB84 and its variants depends on three assumptions. One, validity of quantum mechanics, that is no cloning theorem and indistinguishability of quantum states, those are correct. Validity of quantum mechanics, assumption that no information leakage from the honest parties labs, so no information will be leaked from Alice's lab or Bob's lab. And the fact that the honest parties have a sufficiently good knowledge of their devices. So this is very important point. So Alice and Bob have to know everything, every minute detail of their devices. What is the devices? Here the source and the measurement devices. So for the security of BB84 and its variants, Alice and Bob have to know every minute detail of the source and measurement devices. But this is not very practical. Why? Several times we buy the source and the measurement devices from a third party vendor, and it may happen that the third party vendor may not provide us the actual details. They may provide some wrong details, and in that case the vulnerabilities occurs in the protocols. For example, Alice and Bob know that they are using single photon source, but actually Alice and Bob are using multi photon source in BB84 protocol. If this kind of thing happens, then it can be shown that one attack, photon number splitting attack, mounting this attack, it can extract all the information about the secure key. So removing the third assumption, which is not very practical, is the present trend of the in this domain, and that is called device independent quantum key distribution. So designing device independent quantum key distribution is the present trend in the domain of quantum key distribution. Some important papers on DIQKD, Bronstein, Pirandola, 2012, it published in PRL, Low Kutikai, PRL, Bhajirani Vithik. This is the fully device independent protocol. It is published in PRL in 2015. Now, another example of quantum parallelism. What is used in quantum computation. So if you are given n bit binary string, so there are 2 to the power n many possibility. So if you are given 2 bit strings, if you are given 2 bits, so how what will be the possibility? You can write 00, you can write 01, you can write 10, you can write 11. So there are 4 possibilities. So 2 bits, but 4 possible way you can express these 2 bits. So if you are given 3 bits, so you can see that you can write these 3 bits in 8 many ways. So in that way, if you are given n bits, so then you can express this n bit in 2 to the power n many ways. So in classical domain, but in quantum domain, we can actually create the superposition of all these 2 to the power n many possibilities. How? For that, we need n number of zeros and n number of Hadamard gates. So if we apply n number of Hadamard gates on n number of zeros, then we can create equal superposition of these 2 to the power n many binary patterns. So that is called quantum parallelism. So equal superposition of 2 to the power n states in a single step. We can generate that using n number of Hadamard gate and n number of zeros. So this is another example of quantum supremacy. Now we will see that how using this quantum parallelism we can say something about some function. So one function is called Boolean function. Boolean function is a function which maps 01 to the power n to 01. So n number of inputs consider a classical circuit which can take n number of inputs but outputs only 0 and 1. That is called Boolean function. So n input, n output function. This is not reversible because n input and 1 output, but we know that in quantum domain, quantum gates must be reversible. So how, first thing, how we can make this reversible? For that, we need to design such a quantum circuit which can take n inputs and one extra input y. So the quantum circuit will take n number of inputs and one extra input y. And what it will give us? It will give n inputs, and for y it will give y zor fx. So now n and so there are n plus 1 number of inputs and n plus 1 number of outputs, so the circuit will be reversible. So number of inputs is equal to the number of outputs, so the circuit will be reversible. So in that way we can make the irreversible circuit as reversible. And there is a theorem that if implementation of n in classical domain requires tn gates, the implementation of uf, this is the quantum gate for this f, require order of tn many gates. So if tn is polynomial, then for building uf we also require polynomial number of gates. So in classical domain, if we can design this f by polynomial number of gates, we can design uf in quantum domain by also by polynomial number of gates. Uf should be designed in quantum framework, that is using quantum gates. So using these two things, one is parallelism, so in a single step we can create the superposition of 2 to the power n many bit patterns. And if you are given a classical function f, so then you can always can construct a quantum circuit, reversible circuit of that f. Using these two things, we now see how we can solve some classical algorithms which requires exponential time in classical computer, but which requires constant time in quantum computer. So one example is Deutsch's algorithm. What is the problem? Let f be either constant or balanced function. What is constant function and what is balanced function? If you are given a Boolean function, that is it can take n number of inputs and can outputs only 0 and 1. If for each inputs, each n bit input, it gives you either all zero or all one, then the constant is then f is set constant. And what is balanced? If half of the cases it will give zero and half of the cases it will give one, then the function is called balanced. So let's consider that you are given such function and you are told that the function either be constant or be balanced. Your task is to find what is whether the function is constant or balanced. The deterministic classical algorithm requires 2 to the power n minus 1 plus 1 queries in worst case, and the probabilistic classical algorithm requires a few steps. But using Deutsch's algorithm, we can solve this problem. We can say whether the function is balanced or constant in a single step. This is the circuit for Deutsch's. I am not going to the detail, and this is the mathematical explanation of those circuit. So the final result is that if you get all zero states, then you can say deterministically the function is constant. And if you get any other states other than zero, then you can say deterministically the function is balanced. So in a single step, you can say whether the function is constant or balanced. So this gives you exponential time over the classical, its classical counterparts. So this is another example of quantum supremacy, where we are using quantum parallelism and reversible implementation of classical F, and using that we in a single step we can say whether a function is constant or balanced. Another example is Grover. Here also we are using parallelism and the reversible implementation of function F. Here this is the Boolean function F, and here also in classical domain. So what is the problem? Suppose there exists an x such that fx equals to 1, all the other outputs, suppose that Boolean function f is available as a black box. There exists an x such that fx equals to 1, and for all other inputs, the fx will be 0. So our task is to find the value of x. In classical domain, for finding the value of x, we require 2 to the power n many queries, whereas using Grover's algorithm in quantum domain, we can do that in order of 2 to the power n by 2 queries. Then Simon algorithm, here also we are using quantum parallelism and the reversible implementation of the function f. Here we just change the definition of Boolean function. Here we define Boolean function as 0, 1 as a function f which takes 0, 1 to the power n and gives 0, 1 to the power n. So n inputs and n outputs. And what is our problem? This function is available as a black box. The function satisfies the property that for some s, which is again 0, 1 to the power n, we have for all x and y belongs to 0 to the power n, fx equal to fy, where x not equal to y. So for different x and y, we will get fx equal to fy. And what will be, so and we have to find the value of x where x s equal to x dot y. So in classical domain, to find the value of s, we require 2 to the power n by 2 number of queries, whereas in quantum domain, only using only n number of queries, we can find the value of s. Now Shor algorithm, I already told that Shor algorithm is believed to be heard in classical domain, the best, most efficient classical factoring algorithm. It requires this many steps, so e to the power this log. But using Shor algorithm, we can solve this factorization problem in order of n cube. So this is again exponential speed up over classical domain. Now, what is the cryptographic implications of these algorithms? Doyle-Zuse, this is used in linear approximation of a Boolean function in cryptographic circuit. Grover, for any symmetric crypto system with n-bit secret key, Grover is used to recover the secret key in order up to the power n by 2 using this many queries. Simon, this is exploited in differential cryptanalysis. Shor, complete breakup of public key crypto systems like RSA and ECC. Several papers in top cryptology conference which connect in improving and implementing these results. Now, before finishing the talk, I like to mention that very recently, on 23rd October 2019, Google published one paper, and they claimed that using their 53-qubit quantum processor, which is called Sycamore, they can solve one problem in 200 seconds, which actually requires 10,000 years in classical computers. But there are some controversy. IBM challenges their claim. They found that using some clever strategy, the problem can be solved in 2.5 days in supercomputers. So it is not very clear whether Google actually they are using their 53-qubit quantum processor or they are using supercomputer. IBM challenges that they may use supercomputers and solve the problem in 200 seconds. So whatever the controversy is, the main message from this claim is that we are not very far from quantum era. So we are approaching towards quantum era. So we need quantum preparedness from now. So thank you. Thank you for hearing me for a long time.
Okay, thank you, speaker. Thank you, Orpita, for your this enlightening talk. Actually, I just want to add a thing that for the students, those who are listening to this talk, that if you have a email account, you can log into the IBM's IBM Q Experience, that is the IBM's quantum site, and you can have a feel of what the quantum simulator through which you can do. There are specific examples are there, and you can do whatever you may like. This is a free service, and if you have an institutional login, you can have a better facility. So just a few days ago, IBM had announced that with institutional login, they are going to give additional features. So have a feel with that, and we are now open for questions. As I can see, someone asked me to ask you, the speaker, to explain entanglement and tensor product.
Okay, so tensor product, actually, if I have a white board, then I can explain it clearly. So suppose you have a matrix A, B, C, D, so 2x2 matrix, and E, F, G, H. So what is tensor, and you are said to calculate the tensor product of these two matrix. So matrix A, the elements are A, B, C, D. Matrix B, elements are E, F, G, H. So what you will do, first take A and the matrix B, that means small a, and total matrix E, F, G, H. Then the element of matrix A, B, and E, F, G, H, C, E, F, G, H, D, E, F, G, H, and now just multiply. So now at the end, you will get 4x4 matrix. So 2x2, 2x2, 4x4, you can get 4x4 matrix. And what will be the element? The first element will be AE, then the second element will be AF, third element will be BE, and fourth element will be BF. First row. Second row will be A, EFGH, AG. So in that way, you can calculate the matrix product. tensor product. So take the each element and the second matrix, each element of the first matrix and the second matrix. So in that way, why we are taking tensor product, we are actually taking tensor product, we increase the dimensionality. So from 2 cross 2, we are getting 4 cross 4. From 4 cross 4, we are getting 16 cross 16. So in that way. So this is the tensor product. I think in MSc, they will know that, no?
Yes.
Kaushik, that?
Yes, that is included in the MSc physics course, that tensor product and everything like that.
You can Google it, what is tensor product. So you can find that.
There is another question: how entanglement is consistent with the STR, the special theory of relativity?
Special theory of, actually that is very involved question. So I think we can. I am giving you my email ID, so we can discuss offline because it requires some other things.
Yes, this requires a bit in-depth knowledge about the information processing. For the first time listeners, it will be a bit difficult for them. Just to say that everything is consistent with STR and nothing beats the speed of light. So that is what we stand over here. Okay. And I just want to add another thing for the last question regarding entanglement. See, entanglement is a big domain. So first, in order to learn that thing, entanglement, just by stating that term, entanglement, you are entering a new world. So just to get a feel of that, just what the speaker had said, that and just Google these things and you'll find lots of examples.
Yes. Okay. And getting the feel of entanglement is also very difficult.
Yeah, definitely.
Mathematically, you can say many things. So this is the entire, visualizing physically, this is very difficult.
Okay. Any other question? I think there is no other questions here. Okay. Since there is no other question, I just want to ask one question. What is the present state of research in India? What are the, just since there are so many students involved in this webinar, I just want to ask you, what are the our neighboring institutes, research institutes and research institutes are doing regarding quantum technology, development of quantum technology and quantum information processing?
So here two things are in India actually. So some people, they are doing research on quantum information, totally on quantum information. So teleportation, remote state and all those, discord, entanglement witness, that is actually purely theoretical and this is quantum information based. And another group, they are focusing on quantum cryptography. So there are also two, in cryptography also, two things are there. One is secure communication, QKD, QTRNG. Those are belong to that quantum secure communication. And another is some cryptanalytic. So the Grover, Deuss-Zossa, Simon, Shor. So using those things, how we can get the secret key very quickly. So that is the another domain. So these three things are going in India. So you can choose either quantum information or can choose. And computational thing, complexity, there are very few. One group I know, they are from IIIT Delhi. So only the professor and his students, they are focusing on actual quantum computation. So complexity theory. So these are the research domain as far my knowledge in India. So this is the present state of research in India.
So just to add you one thing, that since this is a very interdisciplinary field of say computer science, physics, electronics, material science, many people are approaching this quantum information, quantum technology field in different aspects. And there are many groups out there, both theory and experimental, they are doing their part. Okay, TIFR group, and in our ISAR Kolkata, even in ISI Kolkata, one is there in both institute, and obviously in HRI Allahabad, obviously yes. IIT Bangalore, CMI, that is the thing. Okay. If there is another question, the difference between supercomputation and quantum computation.
Okay, supercomputation, actually that is classical computation. Using supercomputer, you can do supercomputer, and for quantum computation, you need quantum computer. So you need qubits, you need quantum gates. So this is the difference between supercomputation and quantum computation. Supercomputation is clearly classical. No quantum thing is there. In teleportation, how information transform from one end to another end? I describe the methodology, so that also you can Google, and there is a very good book, Lenson and Chuang, Quantum Information and Computation. There also you find the detail of quantum teleportation. So in teleportation, again, I also mentioned, but again, I like to highlight that no physical particle is transmitted from one location to another location. Only information is transmitted through some local operation and local measurement and classical communication. So Alice communicates Bob through telephone or through WhatsApp or any classical means, some beats. And depending on the beats, Bob will do something at his part, and he will get that state. So this is teleportation. For detail, it is better to discuss some, Google some technical things, or you can read Lenson and Chuang, Quantum Computation and Quantum. Information and Computation. So is there good prospect of this branch of studying in West Bengal at present? Yes, 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 yes. In West Bengal, ISI, then IISc are also. Calcutta University, I don't know.
Yeah, there's a faculty in pure mathematics is doing that.
Okay.
And SN Bose Center for Basic Science, Bose Institute.
Yes, Bose Institute, yes.
Since there is no other questions, I would, then we are going to conclude this webinar. I just now want to ask my departmental colleague, Sugato Chatterjee, to give the vote of thanks.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah,
am I audible?
Yes. Yeah, you are.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Physics Department of Gurudas College, it is my pleasure to take this opportunity to propose the vote of thanks to those who have directly and indirectly contributed to the webinar, Quantum Information and Computation, the Beginning of the New Era, organized by the Physics Department of Gurudas College. First of all, I thank our distinguished speaker, Dr. Orpita Moitro, for her wonderful presentation and making the webinar interesting and fruitful on such a diversified topic. She has really enlightened us with her speech. I would also like to express my
Sugata, please, you just adjust your camera, okay? Okay, it is fine.
Yeah. I would also express my gratitude to our respected principal, Dr. Mousumi Chatterjee, for her constant support and encouragement. I would like to thank the head of the Department of Physics, Dr. Kaushik Nandi, along with all the faculty members of the department and IQAC of Gurudas College for organizing the seminar. Special thanks to our librarian, Dr. Joydeep Chandra, without whose constant support and technical expertise, we would not be able to organize this event. Finally, a warm thanks to the enthusiastic audience, mostly consisting of the students of the physics department and faculty members of not only from our college, but also from the other college, for making the webinar successful. Once again, I thank you all whom I have failed to mention, but whose contribution is equally valuable in organizing the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.